Shalini Devanand, a second year ECE student at CEG at Anna University. I'm also a part of the Gindi Times, the official campus magazine of CEG, AC Tech and SAP. Now, art is a form of expression of the mind. It doesn't matter how it looks. What matters is what it conveys. On behalf of Artist Day, Gindi Times has launched an interview series titled Palette Series, wherein we interview different artists about their work. Without further ado, I welcome Ms. Srishti, who is the face of Anchored Hues and is also an architect by profession and is a well-known watercolor artist and an illustrator. Hi, Srishti.
Hello.
Hello. So, tell me something about yourself, Srishti.
So, my journey in art started at a very young age. I was 2 years old when I went to my first drawing class. And that makes it 22 years since I started holding a pencil or a brush and started drawing or painting. So that's where my journey into art started. And of course, later on, it was my decision to not pursue art as my profession, but maintain it as a second profession or something that I'm really passionate about. Because at the end of the day, for me, art is something that you come back to feel better. So I didn't want that to be my main profession, which is why I took up architecture. So I've always liked history and heritage. And today I'm here studying a master's program that's about urban heritage and how we should think of our cities. So that sort of integrates my love for social science, my love for cities, and my love for art and architecture in general come together. But from in the last 22 years, I think I've learned art from around 4 or 5 teachers. One of whom is my mentor, Sri Venkateswarapathy, who's mentored me for almost 10 years. In fact, he slowly brought me into teaching art, and I used to teach art for three and a half years. And also, he always encouraged me or pushed me to learn on my own. So today I can very happily say that I've learned over 38 different styles of art, and I have taught around 9 of them. And I also teach art history. I also teach art theory. So that's my journey in art. And yeah, that's me. So but if I had to describe myself as an artist, because a lot of people say, oh, I'm a watercolor artist, oh, I'm a digital artist, oh, I'm an acrylic artist, then, I'm a little different that way because I'm a multidisciplinary artist. It's not that I didn't find grounding in one particular style. It's just that art shouldn't be something that's restricted, in my opinion. And as an artist, sometimes when you want to paint a particular subject or paint a particular emotion, you decide that maybe watercolors is not the right medium for me today. Maybe I want to do something else. So that's kind of how my relationship with mediums go. So I am an illustrator. I enjoy and I think I am good at watercolor and ink work, but I wouldn't necessarily fit myself into the box of a watercolor artist. I'm an artist. That's me.
I see. So, Srishti, in your website, you stated that you were tutored under the cartoonist Ranu at the mere age of 3. So, what was the impact left by this teacher of yours which you carry in your day-to-day life? Like, what is one thing which you thank Ranu sir for, which is great?
So, I remember my mother taking me to Ranu sir's house. He had a house, the terrace on somewhere in Aripuram, if I'm not mistaken. And he was like, "Ivlo chinna koyande edhukku class ku ashin varama kudin varama." And then my mother was like, "Illa sir, she is interested in this. She's already been coloring." So my mother used to get me these checkbooks, half in square, one in square, and color pencils, and make me color within the lines. So she's already interested. Sir was like, "Okay, I'm going to teach you how to draw animals with numbers." So my this is one really vivid memory in my head. I don't even know if it's my first class, but he drew the numbers 0 to 9, and he converted each number into an animal. So 1 became a seal, 2 became a swan, 3 became an elephant, and that left a really, really strong impact on me because, hey, you have a well-known artist who draws for the newspaper, sitting and teaching a 3-year-old who probably is just learning how to grasp a pencil in their hand, right? And that's the power of art, and that's what I carry with me today, that anyone can draw, anyone can make art. So that's the impact that that whole episode has had on me, on my journey.
I see. So I can see your journey is really full of, like, you know, many experiences, I must say. Like, you yourself know so many art forms, so indeed it is a vast, you know, journey of experience. So artists, in the society, when we talk, we say the word artist itself, they already have some preconceived notions. Oh my God, it is not as good as being somebody or as being in some other profession or something. So you are already an artist, Rishti, and you're also an architect. So you must have seen both the worlds as well. So as an artist, could you just debunk certain societal expectations and realities?
So, well, unfortunately for me, people do look at architecture also in a very similar way. Architecture is a profession or art is a profession. People seem to think that either you go really big and make a lot of money because you know, have like really high-end clientele, or you're broke. You're not earning, you're not respected, you're not earning money. People don't respect the fact that you can draw, or let's say you put up a postcard and you charge it at 75 rupees a postcard. But then someone will come and be like, idhukku poi 75, your printing cost will be only 5 rupees. No. Because I think that is the biggest preconceived notions that we have around artists, that, if we don't want, let's say you have a friend pursuing art, they want to pursue art full time. இப்போ அந்த பர்சன் ஃபுல் டைம் ஆர்ட் பர்சியூ பண்ணணும்னா தே கேன் பர்சியூ இட் ஒன்லி வென் இட்ஸ் எக்கனாமிக்லி ஃபீசிபிள் ஃபார் தம், வயபிள் ஃபார் தம். அது எக்கனாமிக்லி வந்து லைக் இஃப் இட் ஷுட் பி வயபிள் தென் பீப்புள் ஷுட் பி பையிங் தட் ஆர்ட், பீப்புள் ஷுட் பி லைக் யூ நோ பேட்ரனைசிங் தட் ஆர்ட். வென் வில் தட் ஹேப்பன்? ஒன்லி வென் வி டிசைட் டு ஸ்பெண்ட் ஃபார் ஆர்ட். லைக் இப்போ நம்ம வந்து ஒன்றும் இல்லை, ஐ திங்க் திஸ் இஸ் ஒன் ஆஃப் திஸ் இஸ் அ போஸ்ட் தட் ஐம் யூ நோ பிளானிங் ஆன் புட்டிங் அவுட் சம்டைம். பட் ஒரு ஆவரேஜ் ஸ்விக்கி மீல் கம்ஸ் டு அரௌண்ட் 150 to 200 ருபீஸ். ஐ கேன் கிவ் யூ அ லிஸ்ட் ஆஃப் 50 ஆர்டிஸ்ட் ஆன் இன்ஸ்டாகிராம் ஹூம் ஐ பர்சனலி எம் ஃபாலோவிங் ஆர் வாட் எவர், ஃப்ரம் ஹோம் யூ கேன் பை ஒன் போஸ்ட் கார்ட், ஒன் பிரிண்ட், ஒன் கமிஷன் ஒர்க் இவன் ஃபார் சம் ஆஃப் தம் ஃபார் தட் சேம் 200 ருபீஸ். ஸோ இஃப் யூ சூஸ் டு ஈட் ஒன் மீல் அட் ஹோம் அண்ட் கெட் தட் யூஸ் தட் சேம் மணி டு பை சம்திங் ஃப்ரம் அன் ஆர்டிஸ்ட், you're already working towards breaking down that stereotype of artists are not paid, artists don't do well, artists are not getting money. So that is one thing. Another, like, romba periya, like, it's more like a barrier that people have in their minds, that artists na they party, they enjoy, they have fun, they're not serious about life. I mean, it sounds pretty ridiculous, and I think when you just think of it, when you hear that statement, you'll be like, yaarda idu ipdi la nenikranga endra maadhiri. But trust me, it happens a lot because they are expected to dress in a certain way, very bohemian and andha maadhiri, or edhaadhu or edathukku ponna, oh, you're an artist, no, you must be having fun in life. Like, they all assume that an artist is someone who's been given money or who's been allowed to live a careless life by their parents so that they can practice art or create art, which again is really wrong. And one other thing is that how artist ah irukanona itana varsham padichirukano art padichirukano, or artist ah irna it only means painting. Not just painters are artists, right? Musicians are artists. Photographers practice art of their own kind. You have theater artists. There are so many different kind of artists. So the minute you say, oh, you're doing graphic design, how's that art? You're creating posters on Photoshop, how's that art? what is art? You can't define that question. Then how can you define who an artist is? So I think these are the three biggest things that I've faced personally, and I've seen a lot of my artist friends face as well.
And there's also one more stereotype if I may add, that artists now only if you have like a big bank, if your parents have a big bank balance, can the kid pursue art or something.
Exactly. Like. They say that you have to come from a place of privilege, only then you can pursue art. And I think if recently, we all know about the Rolling Stone incident, right? About how Arifur was not included and the kind of commotion it created. If you're willing to stand up for someone else saying, oh, they haven't been created. Why? Because you've heard a song that became so popular. Then why can't you do it for someone else? I mean, just like how, you know, a caste privilege or a society privilege is exhibited there. That doesn't mean that only because you have money, you can do that for someone either, right? So, yeah, that's definitely another major stereotype that comes in.
Okay, so... See, we all we understand one thing about you is that you really love art more than anything else. But what was it that attracted you specifically to art, which you didn't find in any other skill? For example, you could have gone into music, you could have done something in music, you could have done something in dance. Because these are the three main things, like major things, which someone gets if they say co-curricular. But what was the thing which attracted you to art? I'm comfortable with only art. I don't mind about the other two. What was it?
So, எனக்கு வந்து I learned Carnatic music for 14 years of my life, and ஓரளவுக்கு I learned because my parents really wanted me to. My mother wanted to sing. My grandfather was the secretary of Vani Mahal when it was first established. Great grandfather, her grandfather. So amma ka epome she had that thing of paattu kattukanum. You should like, music is something that's almost like speech in life. It'll always be around you. It'll be a companion for you. So I did learn. But then oru point at mala, the structure that existed in music, you know, that varnam kapra atadala varnam after that kirtana and then alapana, like the whole structure and how like from an audience, it wasn't very welcoming for everyone, especially Carnatic music, in two ways. One, even in while learning, I found myself to be in a group of just similar people who were coming to learn music because their parents wanted them to learn. Maybe I didn't get the right teachers, but that was one thing. And second, even when I went outside and I said that I was a Carnatic musician, I sang Carnatic music. Again, I was falling into this label of, oh, she sings Carnatic, so she'll listen only to classical music. Some of my favorite music is rock music. I do listen to metal also. I mean, but if I walk around wearing a puttu and like a jhumki in college, in India, forget Frankfurt here, people will still say, you're a traditional person. Like, why do we associate certain things to that? And also with dance, I did try to learn dance for around 2 months in my life, after which my teacher had to leave the country because she got a job. But after that, dance, I've had a lot of body image issues growing up. So for me, dance always meant that dancers have good physiques. They look a certain way. They'll be able to, you know, move their bodies in a certain way. I never loved how I looked. I was never accepting of, you know, the fact that maybe I could also dance. But so that was never an option in my head to consider because I wasn't encouraged either. But art was neither like music nor like dance. It was not a performing skill at all. It was something that you could do and then share. It was something that you could just freely express. Maybe dance and music also allow you to express later on. But since I didn't pursue that and I pursued this, it was almost like a sanctuary. Because I remember in my high school, I would go sit in my mentor's studio because I never used to like sitting with the other kids in class. அங்க போய் உட்காந்து I'll go at 8 in the morning and I'll come back home at 7 in the night. So I would have spent the entire day there just painting. And that was a safe space for me. It allowed me to freely create, freely express, and I just held on. It's been there like a best friend for me from that age till today. So yeah.
I see. Art is like more or less like a best friend, like it's something which people don't judge. Are they like, it's what can I say? Some people say the art speaks for itself, the artist doesn't always have to speak. And that brings me to one more question. Right now, this is kind of a debate, I might say, of one famous artist whom we just interviewed. According to that artist, the artist said that yes, some artists feel that they don't have to speak on the work because the work speaks for itself. But then in today's age, if you don't speak for yourself, who will speak for you? So what is your comment on this opinion of this?
So there is this one thing that I keep coming across about how when we look at a piece of art, the person who will know exactly what it means is only the artist. And artists have this nature, it's kind of like an ownership on their work, that while they might have created it out of a particular place, some of them, and I think I am one of those people as well, feel that they would want to give a beginning of what they wanted to, you know, create about, but allow the rest to be interpreted by the person seeing, because that's when it, for me personally, I feel like that's when it gains more meaning. I feel like revealing, for you to reveal everything, it's not like or a chapter or a summary kudukra maadhiri aayidum, because until and unless you read a book, you won't know what the essence of the book is. So until and unless you experience that art, you won't know what the artist or if the artist is speaking to you. You'll walk away instead of actually interacting with it and thinking what it could have meant. Like, for example, let's say you're traveling by train, okay, second class tunnel and the kambi irukko, and you're just traveling anywhere to anywhere for that matter in India. And when you pass by all these fields and those landscapes, perfect landscapes, what you visualize is probably very different from what someone else visualizes, right? The starting point is still the same. For someone, they might think of a Bharati Rajachakaram. For someone, they might think of P.C. Sriramoda, like, you know, still, someone might think of a folk song, someone might think of dance, someone might think of animals, someone might think of colors. It's very different. And there is no right way to analyze art. Because you can talk about, oh, they've used this paint, they've used this technique, this texture, but you can't talk about whether it's right or wrong. It's all open to your interpretation. So, yeah, I mean, if you want to be someone who leaves everything to, you know, another person's interpretation, then you can say my art speaks for itself. Especially when it comes to political pieces, when it comes to social justice related pieces, I think it's important for the art to speak for itself, because it really makes you question what the art is about, and then maybe read further to know about that issue. But other way, if I'm talking about a narrative, a personal narrative, it's my journey, my view, my opinion, then it's important to add something as a starting point, but allow the art to speak for itself.
So, if I may get it right, not every 6 is a 9. Maybe. That's the famous saying.
Kandipa, yeah.
Okay. So, what do you feel is the difference between, what can you say? You've had the best of both the worlds, being an artist as well as an architect. So, how is it being like in your kunjo, like you're a part-time artist, you're a part-time architect. So, how do you like bridge the gap? Obviously, you'll be facing many challenges. There'll be many pros and cons, because it's not a... it's not a simple
Definitely,
thing to manage
yeah.
two professions and give your best at the same time. So, how do you do it?
To be very honest, I'm just getting started out on managing both together, and social media really does not help, because a lot of times you reach that point where you see someone else who's building a small business, building a brand, slowly transitioning from one profession into being a full-time artist or a full-time maker. And that's amazing. I really applaud these people, but I don't think I can do it because it's not like, you know, the job as a full-time artist is only going to be to paint, or maybe you'll reach a stage where you can employ someone to help you with the other back-end work, but it means packing orders, sending orders, managing things, marketing yourself, putting your brand out there, until and unless you, you know, create a strong impression. Because adhu pandra varaikkum there are just 100 artists around you. And as far as architecture goes, well, right now at least the field is something where as freshers you don't get a lot of opportunities. You really have to step up for yourself and say, okay, I want to practice on my own. I want to take up these kind of projects. I want to work at an office that has these kind of projects. So I've had a lot of lows of, you know, maybe I should just post start for my sake and take up a full-time job that pays me. But really the question is, what kind of an architect do you want to be? What kind of an artist do you want to be? And I think that's where I found my grounding, because for me, my goal with Anchored, which is my studio, is that I should try and break the barrier that's there between general public and art, and promote the idea that art is for everyone. So I am planning on a series of art for mindfulness, for calming. I'm planning a memory art where you think of a memory and sketch. Well, it really is about connecting with your inner child and saying that somewhere at some point of time in life you would have created that perfect scenery, you know, with those two mountains and that sunrise in between and those V-shaped crows and one house and one river. That house will have that triangular. So all of us have done it. And I believe that if you connect with that person in you, then you will be expressing something in your head. And that is my goal with Anchored Youth. And I think as an architect, I and now as an urbanist, I guess cities really do that to you. So I would like to use cities as a connector to achieve this goal of mine. So all my art is going to be city-based. As an architect, again, I'm not fond of designing for people who have money to build independent houses. At the same time, in the Madri modular create pani, slum development panano, abindra asiyam enakku illa. But what is a city? If art is for everyone, the city is also for everyone, right? So I'm looking at what are the kind of spaces exist in the city, the urban realm, and how these spaces can be made more accessible for everyone. A kid, a person with a walking stick, a person on a wheelchair, a person who doesn't have one leg, a person who cannot see, everyone should be able to use the space in a manner that's comfortable for them. And there was a famous comic, how there'll be one tree and everyone will be asked to climb that tree, saying that's how our education system is. But isn't that also how a lot of spaces are? You should have a scenery where each person can choose what is comfortable for them while enjoying the entire scenery. Like a duck might want to sit on the banks, a monkey might want to climb the tree, a cat or dog might just want to sit on the grass. But ellarku andha tree un theriyum, grass un theriyum, river un theriyum, banks un theriyum. But so that's how spaces should be like. So my goal again there is towards breaking that accessibility barrier, and because that is my ultimate goal, it sort of connects in a very interesting way and it keeps me going. So I actually have so that scenery that I was talking about is basically this, right? Can you see it?
Yeah, it's
just that house and those trees and that sun. I mean, this is a postcard that I picked up here in Germany near my university, but that's the scenery that I'm talking about. All of us have drawn that. Every one of us have drawn that. So it's all there somewhere within us. So yeah.
Yeah, so that's what I mean. There's a famous meme on that as well. 135 crore Indians, if you ask them to draw a scene in Italy, it'd be only like a house and two trees and two birds, and as you described.
Yeah.
So I guess you need to give that creative element. You need the person to be on their own. You rightly stated it. The person has to be on their own, and you can't expect a fish to fly and an eagle to swim. So
yeah, kandipa.
So artists, like ella profession kume, for all professions they deal with some kind of a mind block. Writers to write, they say writer block, writer's block. So as an artist as well, how do you deal with these art blocks? So how do you respond to them?
A lot of times when I don't feel like creating, I don't create. I allow myself that time to take a step back from art, because it can get overwhelming. It's just like when you're really sad or you're really upset or really angry, you end up crying, right? And until you really until you cry and then remain silent for some time, you're not going to get back to that normalcy. So crying is an expression. Art is also an expression. So sometimes when you're just not able to cry, you're just not able to create, you just take a pause, some time for yourself, and you'll be able to get back into it. And I think because I'm not a full-time artist, I have the privilege of saying, okay, I will not create today. I understand that full-time artists cannot do that. They have to find a way to create. So in such circumstances, like even I take up commission work, and when I have a submission or like a deadline to meet, client deadline to meet, I usually keep aside my commission work. I just take a blank piece of paper, pick any medium that comes to my mind, could be watercolors, pastels, anything, and I allow, you know, the mind to flow. Sometimes it'll just be scribbles, sometimes I'll end up creating something, sometimes I'll just continuously draw lines in the same direction, and that sort of helps ease the mind into getting into that creative flow. So both of these have honestly really helped me, so I've never had to think of anything beyond. But if you are an artist and you're facing that, then I think stepping outside, changing your environment, going for a walk, listening to some music, all of this definitely helps. It's basically about taking that pause, right? Because you're not able to think clearly. It's what you would do when you're studying. It's the same thing. So yeah, I think that should help.
Okay. Now, Vandal, through your bio on your Instagram, we all can understand you have a very good fondness for the city of Madras, more than any other city which you have ever featured. So, what makes it stand out for you? And also, why Inktober? What inspired you? What was so special that made you to do Inktober? And, you know?
So, Madras is where I've grown up, where I was born, where I've grown up, and when I was studying, when I was doing my bachelor's in Bangalore, I realized how much I miss the city, especially the beach. Because my music class used to be next to the beach. My first internship office used to be next to the beach. So office mudichita nera I'll go to the beach. Or class mudichita nera my parents will take me to the beach. Illanalo every week or every second week we used to go to the beach. So what started out as a love for the beach, slowly as I learned more about architecture and other things, became a love for the city. And also how Bondi Bazaar transformed into this sport pedestrian thing, and that made me really nostalgic for the old Bondi Bazaar with the shops on both sides, platform, and just that smell of that fresh mallipu, or actually rose, and the pink rose idu kattuvaanga. And like so many local professions you used to encounter. So it was all just small starting points that sort of became one larger web. And I think last year during the pandemic, the Madras Inspired Shoes series that I did, it's now a research work that's being presented by me at a conference in Greece in December about how colors can be used as a way to map cities. So anga aarambichu, then it became, thanks to Kiparasundari Sevel, of course I would not be right if I don't mention her name. So anga aarambichu pannadu, just it sparked up so many conversations, so many memories about the city. And then I was like, if so many people talk about a city, then why not have something inclusive for everyone to join in about the city. So then it was September and I had painted live every day for 32 days. So I needed a break. So I was like, "Sorry, September, I don't panna vanna. Let's think about October." And I have been, you know, taking up the Inktober prompts for 3-4 years now. So then I was like, "Sorry, Inktober maandhi yosikame." Because each time I've started the Inktober, I have not finished. Because at one point, the work that everyone posts will become so daunting. என்னடா அது எல்லாரும் இவ்வளவு நல்லா பண்றாங்களே நமக்கு வரவே வர மாட்டேங்குது அப்படின்னா அந்த ஒரு ப்ரெஷர். அண்ட் ஆல்சோ ஹவ் ரேண்டம் த ப்ராப்ஸ் பி லைக் யூல் ஹாவ் ஃபிஷ், யூல் ஹாவ் ரிங், யூல் ஹாவ் சம்திங் லைக் டைம், லைக் இட் வாஸ் ஜஸ்ட் சோ ரேண்டம் ஃபார் மீ. அண்ட் ஐவ் நெவர் ட்ரைட் கீப்பிங் அ தீம் டு இட், மேபி இஃப் ஐ டிட் ஐ வுட் ஹவ் டன் பெட்டர். சோ தட் ஹேப்பன். சோ தென் ஐ வாஸ் லைக், சரி, வாட் இஸ் சம்திங் தட் எவ்ரி ஒன் கனெக்ட்ஸ் டு சிட்டி? மெட்ராஸ். So, மெட்ராஸ் வச்சு நம்ம ஒரு ப்ராம்ப்ட் லிஸ்ட் கிரியேட் பண்ணோம் அப்படின்னா தென் எவ்ரி ஒன் வில் பி ஏபிள் டு திங்க் அண்ட் அட்லீஸ்ட் அவங்களுக்கு ஒரு டீம் இருக்கிற மாதிரி இருக்கும். ஸோ தே வோன்ட் ஹாவ் டு ஸ்பெண்ட் டூ மச் டைம். ஸோ தென் இட் வாஸ், சரி, மெட்ராஸ் இன்டோவர் பண்ணலாம். தட்ஸ் வென் ஐ ரீச்ட் அவுட் டு ஆஃப்ரீன் அண்ட் பர்ஃபெக்ஷா அண்ட் வி வெலக் சரி ஓகே பண்ணலாம். அண்ட் தென் வி கிரியேட்டட் த ப்ராம்ப்ட். ஸோ லாஸ்ட் இயர் வென் வி கிரியேட்டட் த ப்ராம்ப்ட், வி ஹேட் லைக் தீஸ் கேட்டகரிஸ், emotions, color, architecture, elements, and madri. And then we created the prompt. Then we had around 60 people participate last year. So then this year we were like, "Sari, thirupi pannalam, but let's not have 31 prompts. Oru oru vaarathukku apparam oru break vidalam. So people who haven't done can catch up. Or it gives them time to sort of think for the next week. So suddenly they're not left with the enada pannalam." So then I was like, "Sari, oru vaarathukku oru naal like break kudukka porona, that means we'll have around 25-26 days. Why not think of the alphabet?" So it became 26 days of Madras Inktober using the alphabet as prompt starters. And then we created the prompt. Listen again, this time, so last time what happened was Nariya was architectural elements. So a lot of people who wanted to do dance or music or write poetry were like, "Ah, romba architectural la irukke nadul nadula appdin." So in the tharuva we were like, "Sari, avlo architectural la vekka venda, we'll think a little beyond that." So we thought of things like education, business, community, which again can be interpreted in many ways, right? Like, I think development ku Sahana Chitram Sendodas, she had drawn how you go from அந்த மெக்கானிக்கல் பென்சில் அடுக்கு அடுக்கா இருக்குமே அது டு அ நட்ராஜ் ஹெச்பி பென்சில் டு லைக் அ பால் பாயிண்ட் பென் ஆர் லைக் அ மெக்கானிக்கல் பென்சில் தட் இஸ் ஆல்சோ டெவலப்மெண்ட் ரைட் டெவலப்மெண்ட் இஸ் நாட் ஜஸ்ட் பில்டிங்ஸ் ஸோ ஐ எம் ஹேவிங் அ லாட் ஆஃப் ஃபன் என்ஜாயிங் த கைண்ட் ஆஃப் என்ட்ரிஸ் ஆர் கமிங் இன் திஸ் இயர் திங் சம்மன் வாஸ் சம்மன்ஸ் பீன் ட்ராயிங் காமிக்ஸ் ஆல்சோ So it's fun, and at the end of the day, that's why you do Inktober, right? To get people together, not to challenge anyone, not a competition, it's just bringing people together. So yeah, that's why I made us Inktober.
Oh, that's really great, and I must say, that's really, the person must be really thinking out of the box, especially your friend Sana, that mechanical pencil and all that
stuff.
Yeah. So it's really nice. In fact, do you have any recent artworks with you right now?
I can show you the Madras Inktober that I've posted so far. So this year for my Madras Inktober, my theme is about connecting Germany and Madras. So because I'm in Germany right now, and of course I really miss Madras. But at the same time, not many people know of the connection that Germany has with India or Madras for that matter. ஸோ அப்படி யோசிக்கிறச்சு அவர் சார், சரி, வை நாட் டாக் அபவுட் கனெக்ஷன்ஸ். நம்ம எல்லாருக்கும் வந்து இருக்கிற தினமோ இஸ் த வேர்ல்ட் வார் எம்டன் பாம்ப் பண்ணலாம். பட் தென் தெர் இஸ் சோ மெனி அதர் அண்ட் ஆல்சோ சம் திங்ஸ் ஆன் அ டெய்லி பேசிஸ் ரைட் சிமிலாரிட்டிஸ் அண்ட் டிஃபரன்சஸ் லைக் இப்போ பிஸ்னஸ்க்கு ஐ போஸ்டட் அபவுட் ஹவு திஸ் சிட்டி ஷட்ஸ் டவுன் ஆன் சண்டே. இப்போ நான் வீட்டை விட்டு வெளியில போனேன் ஆன் சண்டே அப்படின்னா ஹவுசஸோட விண்டோஸே சாத்திருக்கும், ஷட்டர் போட்டு சாத்திருக்கும். கடை வந்து ஷட்டர்ன்ற கான்செப்டே கிடையாதுங்க, தேர் ஆர் ஜஸ்ட் கிளாஸ் டோர்ஸ், பட் இட் பி க்ளோஸ், யூ கான்ட் கோ, யூ கான்ட் பை எனி திங், யூ கான்ட் மீன் கோ டு த ஃபார்மசி அண்ட் கெட் எமர்ஜென்சி மெடிசன், மேபி யூ வில் ஹாவ் அ ஃபியூ ஷாப்ஸ் ஆர் இன் தேர் தட் ஆர் ஓபன், But for me, Sunday is when we'll go buy kaigari for the week. We'll buy param for the week. Market go and the kattapai eduthu go buy and come. Or you went to paramadesh and come next. So those things. And also the kind of colors, right? When you walk in Madras, you'll have these indigo boards, yellow color walls, green color walls, and these akkas and annas wearing like colorful saris and lungis and selling fresh produce. Whereas India, it's all like, it's quite organized and glass shop fronts and the madri. So that is when, so in the madri and small things and differences is what I wanted to bring out this year during my Inktober. So that's my meta Inktober this year.
That's really nice, really thoughtful of you, I must say. Because as you said, Germany and India, Germany and Chennai, we don't really think much about it. We just know in our history textbooks, it's World War II and that's it. And yeah. It's just another place to do your higher studies. We don't really look at the small things. I must say, you do have an eye for like observing things and noticing the beauty. How many small things which people might not even consider much, like consider even a pen cap or a flower or a bed or anything. So, how has your power of observation helped you, other than art? Art, of course, your work speaks for itself. But other than art, in your in all your other activities, how do you think your power of observation has helped you?
I write a lot. I love taking photos. I write a lot. I have a travel blog of my own. I keep posting. Very inactive right now, but I keep posting. I guess I just like being different, because ellaro on the street photography na, that perfect, you know, that typical Pondicherry photo, yellow wall with that white frame and one blue door or white door or whatever, I don't like those pictures. I mean, no offense to those who take it, they're wonderful photos, but there is no life in them in my eyes. So I've always liked to observe something small, something different, something that will make me remind, that will remind me of that taste. Like for example, yesterday I went on this Iron Bridge, Frankfurt, and they put all these logs with, you know, the names written, heart, and the logs, there was this one gold plate, one QR code, scan for it. So obviously curiosity kills the cat. I scanned the code, but it was for an emotional, like a healing therapist. So now I'll always remember that particular QR code on that bridge amidst that whole sea of logs, right? So Annamadri, it's, for me, it's really about the details and remember, and how these tiny things that you observe really help you in remembering a place, like sealing a memory in your head. So I think it helps me that way. It's definitely helped me with my studies, because college la vandu na summa rendu moonu page paathutu seri po exam polana irukku, and I remember, oh, this was written in blue ink on the right side of the page, no enna ezhudirne appdi sollu na answer edu. So I have a photography memory that so it really helps me, I guess.
It's really nice. I mean, what can I say? Blue wing on the right side. That's really, what can I say? Like at the next level.
Yeah, that's how I passed half my exam in college. Yeah, I'll be like, okay, history. This was happening in this class. Apna in the sequence na irukum. Sequence, of course, all of us remember. So then I was like, nana panidne. And then I tried to visualize my sketchbook in which I've taken notes. And I'll be like, oh, this page I've written this. Okay, this is the answer.
See, that's really wonderful, I must say. Like, you know, to remember things with so much of detail, and you know, that's really wonderful, Srishti. And one more thing, right now in the social media age, there's a lot of plagiarism that happens, a lot of cheating that happens, copycat, so many things happen. There are so many words for that. And what is your opinion on that? Have you ever experienced such a thing happening to you, or like, what is your opinion on this?
So I've not had people directly copying my work out there, but I've had a lot of instances, especially in the last 1 year, of people copying my ideas and pitching it to these really big names, big firms, saying, oh, I want to do Colors of Madras, or oh, I have such and such an idea. Or, you know, there are pages that have come up with this, with prompts very similar to our Madras Inktober prompts, for example. And the Madri Nadangal, okay. But also what I've learned out of experience is that people who try and copy don't really get anywhere, because idea nu original ah irundha da you can go somewhere with it. Nee vera orthoroda idea eduthu nee panna porana, you can only go, it's just like an art piece la. I can copy a Ravi Verma painting appadiye. I might know the technique, but I'll never know the color. I will never know what the original scene was from which he drew. I'll never know the intention or idea behind that art. So that's what happens. But again, that is only helping you deal with the whole situation, cope with the whole situation. It really bothers me. I mean, if you are an artist who genuinely puts effort into your own work, you'll know how much effort goes into conceptualizing it. So why would you be okay if someone did that to your work? If the answer to that question is no, then you shouldn't be taking someone else's work. If the answer to that is yes, then you're an immoral person, let's face it. Like, in your right mind, you wouldn't do it. So it's really unfortunate. Coming to like other forms of plagiarism, where, you know, these big pages and Instagram handles just take some random artist's art and post it. I think the Nesimani memes are nadula vandhuchinade. Appo they took someone's work. Ippo recent some other Vadivelu work they've taken. It's really sad. I mean, if you're a company that has 100k followers on Instagram, then definitely you can pay that artist and then take their work rightfully. And it's also in the small things, right? If you are posting, like as a student, if you're going to post something and you're taking text from somewhere, even if it's Wikipedia, source Wikipedia, it takes you 5 seconds to type that one line of source. It's okay. If you have done the research, then you put source own, research done by me. It's great. Let people know that it's your work. If it's not from you, credit the person who's done that work. If you can search and go and pick it from some blog, from some website, from some book, then it's because that person has taken the efforts to put it out there. Even if it's a Wikipedia or a Google blog or like a random email forwarded, none of the answers are the same. So take the efforts to credit people. It's very important to credit sources. And I think if all of us start doing that, we can genuinely reduce the kind of plagiarism that happens. Because everyone's connected on social media. If you have 1,000 followers, each of those followers will have like another 500 people following them, 100 people following them, 5,000 people following them. So many people are seeing it. So the minute you spot something somewhere, someone somewhere is going to know it's yours. And it will come back to you. It's not going to go unnoticed. Do it rightfully.
I mean, even our school booklets and all, our teachers sometimes are like, add this page called bibliography towards the end and all that stuff. No? So, yeah. Right. It is time people start giving credit to the people who actually did the work. That's when we can see a better society. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, what is your view on Palette series? What is your view on this entire series featuring artists and their work? What do you feel about it?
I think it's really nice because especially the kind of questions that we've had today, the kind of conversation we've had today, it talks about a lot of different opinions, about different ways of looking at art and artists, more than it being like, while I spoke about my personal journey, it was a lot about what I think art is or what I think art should be. And those are very, very important conversations that we should have. It really contributes to a larger understanding of artists in society. So a great kudos to Hindi Times for taking this initiative. It's not easy to just come up with a set of artists, and it's very easy to just say, how many years have you been practicing art, what's your favorite kind of art, blah 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 blah. But this is not something that's very widely spoken about. So thank you so much for, you know, reaching out to me and having me here. I really hope that my dialogue with you today pushes people to pursue art further. I think that would be my greatest win, if someone can feel motivated to say, okay, I don't have to be an artist to paint and pick up a pencil or pick up a pen. So yeah, I think that's what I have to say. And I'm really looking forward to the entire palette series once it's all out.
Thank you, Swishi. Thank you so much. And yes, thank you for your time as well, I must say, because despite your busy schedule, you still, you know, you took our time and you gave us this interview. Thank you so much for that. And on a final note, what is a message that you would like to pass on to the budding designers and artists?
I don't want to sound preachy, but guys, just show up, keep practicing. The power of practice is just unparalleled. Don't set goals like I should finish one art piece today. Set smaller goals like I should sketch for 5 minutes today. I should work on something for 5 minutes today. Whether you make 15 pieces in 1 month or one great piece in 1 month, as long as you're showing up for yourself, that's good. And don't compare yourself to other artists. It can be really negatively impacting your own mental health, and nothing should affect your own mental health. Compare yourself to who you were yesterday, but don't be hard on yourself. Like, if you've learned something new, celebrate it. If you haven't done your best today, it's okay.
Those are really motivating and inspiring, because comparison is something which always runs, especially in the education sector. Oh my god, he or she is better than me. Oh my god, he or she is doing this, doing that. So without even us knowing, we compare ourselves. We don't even need societal pressure. We ourselves are enough for comparing.
Yeah.
So I mean, that's a really good point which you pointed out. So we'll surely keep that in mind. And that is all for today. Thank you so much for your valuable time and the interview and your words. It really meant a lot. And hoping to see you soon in the future.
Definitely, yes.
Okay, Srishti, take care.
Yes. Thank you so much.